We are on page 12, Tayyib, and we're in the second to last sentence. Page 12 of my class notes, the ones that I put out on the group, second to last sentence, right? Just a quick apology. You've noticed on the updated notes there's a repetition. Bab for the wudu. My updated notes, there's a repetition. You will find that when we come to the obligatory aspects of wudu, it's been repeated twice on my notes, right? So when we come to that, you can navigate that inshallah. In any case, the Imam, he says, Bismillah wa rahmatullahi wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah wa ma'alimna ma yanfa. He says, the Imam, he says that everything which comes out from your private parts, you have to make istinja for it, right? Except for passing wind. So anything that comes out to your private parts, you have to make istinja for it. Istinja here means both istinja and istijma. Because when it's used by itself, istinja, it includes both of them. Okay? So anything that comes out of the private parts, whether it's pure, okay, like a stone. For example, if a stone comes out of your private parts and it has on it najasa, the stone, then you have to make istinja because of that. But if the stone came out, because the stone is tahir, it's pure, and it didn't have any wetness with it, any najasa with it, it was completely dry, then there is no need for you to make istinja or istijma, okay? Also, an exception of this rule that anything which comes out from the private parts requires you to make istijma or istinja. The Imam mentioned the exception is wind. Also, is mani. Mani is semen. Semen, okay? For the man or the woman, it's pure, and you don't have to make istinja from that. But it's good, of course, to wash if that comes out. The Imam says, وَلَا يَصِحُّ قَبْلَهُ وُضُوءٌ وَلَا تَيَمُّمٌ. That if something comes out from your private parts, if something comes out from your private parts, and you make wudu without removing this, then your wudu or your tayammum is not accepted. So the purification that you do is conditioned upon, if you are in a situation where something came out from your private parts, you have to remove that first. What is the evidence of this? The evidence is the hadith of Ali radiallahu anhu, where he said, كُنْتُ رَجُلًا مَثَّاءً فَاسْتَحْيَيْتُ أَنْ أَسْأَلَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمَ مَكَانَةِ ابْنَتِهِ مِنِّي مَكَانِ ابْنَتِهِ مِنِّي فَأَمَاتُهُ بِغْدَادِ بْنْ أَسْوَدِ فَسَأَلَهُ فَقَالَ يَغْسِلْ بَكْرَهُ وَيَتَوَضَّى. So Ali radiallahu anhu, he said, I used to be a man who had a lot of madhi. Madhi is that which is, it comes out if you have erotic thoughts, or it comes out before you're about to have relations with your family, with your wife, okay? It's a sticky liquid, it comes out and it's considered to be something which requires to be washed. So in the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ told Ali to Miqdad ibn Aswad that tell him to wash this and then make wudu. So this is the proof of the Hanbali scholars that first you need to remove the najasa, then you need to make wudu, okay? Based on the hadith of Ali. Another opinion in the madhab, excuse me, is that it can be after wudu, right? Because in the hadith in Sahih Muslim, the Prophet ﷺ said, تَوَضَّعْ وَانْضَحْ فَرْجَكْ. Make wudu and then wash your private part. Okay? So those who hold the second opinion, which they say that no, you can make wudu even if you have najasa on your body. Even if you have some najasa on your body, you can make wudu and your wudu is valid. But when it comes to the time of prayer, then it's a must for you to remove the najasa before you pray. So the najasa doesn't affect the wudu. The najasa of the body doesn't affect the wudu, right? But of course, nobody in their right mind would behave in such a manner to want to have najasa on their body whilst making wudu, etc. The Imam says, بَابُ السِّوَاكْ وَسُنُّ الْوُدُوءُ. The chapter of the siwak and the sunnah of wudu. Yeah? The chapter of siwak and the sunnah of wudu. So siwak is oud, is a stick which is used, okay, to clean the mouth. يَسْتَاكُ is the verb, is the action of cleaning the mouth. So look at the titling of the author, Al-Hajjawi, rahimahullah. He said the chapter of the siwak and the sunnah of the wudu. What do you find a bit strange here? The chapter of siwak and the sunnah of wudu. siwak and the sunnah of wudu. Siwak in of itself is part of the sunnah of wudu. So why did the Imam mention it separate? Exactly, so the siwak has a lot of importance in our deen, and it's important at all times, not just for wudu. This is why the author mentioned it alongside the sunnah of wudu. Even though it's from the sunnah of wudu, he mentioned it separately to show you that it's sunnah to use at all times, not just for the wudu, right? So as we said, siwak is the tool that you use to clean your mouth, and the tasawwuq is the verb, okay? Wudu, the word wudu comes from al-wada'atu. Al-wada'atu has the meaning of cleanliness and good appearance. They say wajhun wudi. So wudu comes from al-wada'atu, okay? If you say wudu, that is the action, the dhamma. If you say with the fatha, it's the thing, the water that you make the wudu with. So wudu with the dhamma is the action. Wadu, as we'll come to know later in the hadith of Uthman, is the thing that you make the wudu with. Right? Technically, its definition is tathiru al-a'da al-arba'a ala wajhi al-maqsus. Tathiru al-a'da al-arba'a ala wajhi al-maqsus. Purifying the four limbs in a specific way. Purifying the four limbs in a specific way. They give another definition which is similar to this. They say, ghusl a'da al-arba'a ala wajhi al-maqsus. Washing the four limbs in a specific manner. See the difference? The first definition I gave you, tathir al-a'da al-arba'a ala wajhi al-maqsus. Purification of the four limbs in a specific manner. The second definition said, ghusl al-a'da al-arba'a, washing the four limbs ala wajhi al-maqsus in a specific. Which one do you think is more correct or more better for us to use? Allahu Akbar, Ahsan Allah ilayk. Very good, Jazakallah khair. And this is as Shaykh Ahmed Khalil, he said that the first one is better because not all of the body parts are washed. Like the brother mentioned to us, may Allah reward him, that you don't wash your hair. Therefore, the first one is a closer definition as mentioned by Shaykh Hassan al-Da'ila. Shaykh Hassan al-Da'ila in his explanation. So the Imam, he says, that the tasawwuq bi'udin layl, that the tasawwuq, the action, should be with the ud, with the stick, which is soft, layl, munqin. Munqin, you heard this before when we were talking about removing najasa. Munqin means that it should lead to cleanliness. Okay, it shouldn't be a type of siwak that when you use it, it causes your mouth to become more dirty. Instead of clean, right? So it should be munqin. Munqin means it leads to cleanliness. غير مضر. غير مضر means it shouldn't harm you. لا تتفتت. And it shouldn't break apart. Okay? It shouldn't fall apart in your mouth. لا بإصبعٍ وخلقةٍ. Nor can you make siwak with your finger or a khilqa. Khilqa is a piece of cloth. Okay? So this is the relied upon opinion of the madhab. Another opinion in the madhab of Ibn Qudam and others, they say you can use your finger in the absence of the siwak. You can use your finger in the absence of the siwak, and you will be rewarded according to the amount of cleanliness you achieve with your finger. طيب. So in the absence of siwak, you can use your finger. Our from and the madhab is saying no. But Ibn Qudam, who is also from the major scholars of the madhab, from the major scholars of Ahl Sunnah, he said you can. They have a rule in fiqh, they say ma la yudrak kullahu, لا يدرك كله. And sometimes they say لا يدرك جله. ما لا يدرك كله. That which you cannot achieve from a thing, all of it, لا يدرك كله. All of it then should not be left off. Okay? That which you cannot achieve from an act, all of it, then you shouldn't leave all of it off. You should do what you can. ما لا يدرك كله. ما لا يدرك كله. لا يدرك كله. طيب. So Ibn Qudami said, in the absence of the siwak, you can do what? You can
use the finger.
Use your finger. The Imam, he says, masnoon kulla waqtin. That it's recommended, it's sunnah at all times, right? We have in the hadith of Ahmad al-Nisa'i, where the Prophet said, as-siwak matharatun lil-fam, matbaatun lil-rab. That the siwak is purifying for the mouth and pleasing to your Lord. It's pleasing to your Lord. Action. You pick up the siwak and you just do this and you get reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You made Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pleased. Okay? وَطْحَلَةٌ لِلْفَمْ وَمَدَّاتٌ لِلْرَبْ بِغَيْرِ سُوَى qa'imin ba'da zawal. But the Imam here makes an exception. He said, except for the one who's fasting after zawal. What is zawal? Good, after the sun has passed its zenith, right? The afternoon. So at this time, the Imam is saying you shouldn't use the sea work. In the hadith in Bukhari Muslim, the Prophet said, La khalufa fa musa'im atyahu inna walladhi nafsu Muhammad bi yadihi. La khalufa fa musa'im atyahu inna Allahi muliha misk. By the one who has the soul of Muhammad in his hand, meaning Allah Azza wa Jalla. Verily, the smell of the one who is fasting in his mouth is more beloved to Allah Azza wa Jalla than the smell of musk. Right? So what is the proof from this hadith in Bukhari and Muslim for what the Imam just said? The Imam, he said that siwak shouldn't be used for the one who is fasting after siwak. So looking at this hadith I gave you, what is the proof? What is the wajh? At-dalal for this. Wajh at-dalal, what is it? The way of understanding the proof. Good. Did you say not to get rid of the smell? Exactly. Because the smell, according to this opinion, is the athar, the effect of the ibadah. Like the shaheed. The shaheed, when he dies, he's raised with his blood. He's not to be washed because you don't want to remove the athar of the ibadah. So this opinion is saying that if you use the siwak after midday, then the smell which is emanating from your mouth and is more beloved to Allah than musk, then you will remove that smell, right? So this is the opinion based on this hadith and other narrations. Ahmad, Imam Ahmad himself, and Ibn Taymiyyah, and others, they said, no, you can use the siwak at any time. Why? Because they said that the smell emanates not from the mouth, but from the stomach. So no matter what you do to your mouth, that smell, whilst fasting, is not going to disappear, right? And the interesting thing is that Shaykh Al-Hajjawi himself, the author of this book, the author of Zad, in Al-Iqna, he holds this opinion. Okay? As mentioned by Shaykh Abdullah Jalassar. What does the Imam say next? مُتَأَكِّدٌ إِنَّ صَلَاةٌ وَإِنْتِبَاهٍ وَتَغَلُّ الْفَمِ. It's more stressed at the time of the prayer and when the person is waking up from sleep and when there's a change of smell or color in the mouth. So in the hadith in Bukhari, Muslim, the Prophet said, لَوْلَا أَلْتَشُقَّ عَلَى أُمَّتِي لَأَمَرْتُمْ لِسَوَاكُ مَعْ كُلِّ صَلَاةٍ. And in one narration, إِلَّا كُلِّ صَلَاةٍ. Had it not been difficult for my ummah, the Prophet said, I would have ordered them with the siwak at every prayer. At every prayer, right? So it's stressed in the prayer time for you to make the siwak. When is it stressed for you to use the siwak? When should I use the siwak? In the prayer time. What does it mean? Before the prayer. Why not during the prayer? Because we have to have khushu in the prayer, right? And movements which are not required in the prayer will take away from the khushu. And that's something which is forbidden for us. So like the brother mentioned correctly, it's before the prayer, at the time of the iqama, or before that, inshallah. And the Imam said, وَإِنْتِبَاهِمْ. And when the person gets up from sleep. In Bukhari Muslim, you have the hadith of Hudayfa رضي الله عنه, who said, كَانَ النَّبِي صَلَّى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمَ إِذَا قَامَ مِنَ اللَّيْلِ يَشُّو سُفَاهُ بِالسِّوَاكِ. That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, when he used to get up from night, he used to rub his teeth with the siwak. Yashusu means to rub his teeth with the siwak, right? And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, through his beautiful manners, he always used to do this also, even when entering upon the house, when entering upon his wives. And the amazing thing is that the smell of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was a beautiful smell. Never did he smell bad, yet still he would always use the siwak, teaching us the ummah. Because many of us, when we enter upon our houses and our wives, we have that dragon proof, right? We don't keep ourselves clean. But it's something which is imperative for us to do. And Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he said, إِنِّي لَأُحِبْ أَنَا تَزَيَّنْ لِزَوْجَتِي كَمَا أُحِبْ أَنَا تَزَيَّنَ لِي. He said, verily, I love to beautify myself for my wife like the way I love that she beautifies herself for me. So using this work, entering upon the house, is something which is very much impressive for us to do. So the Imam says, وَيَسْتَاقُ عَرْضًا مُبْتَدِئًا بِجَانِبِ فَمِّي الْأَيْنِ. That the person, when he's using this work, he goes from side to side of his mouth. And he starts from the right hand side. Right? He goes from side to side of his mouth, and he starts from the right hand side. Sheikh Hamad al-Hamad, in his explanation, he said, there's nothing authentic which dictates to you how you should make the miswak in terms of side to side or up and down. So that was the dentist's or the people of expertise pertaining to the mouth, that which they advise you is the one that you should do, right? Regarding starting with the right, like the Imam said, this is something which of course is recommended. So in terms of left to right, or up and down, we said that this is for the people of Tafsir. The people who have expertise in, these are the ones we refer to. But in terms of starting from the right itself, this comes under the general heading of the hadith in Bukhari Muslim narrated by Aisha radiallahu anha, which he said, كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يعجبه التيام في تنعله وترجله وطهوره وفي شعره كله. That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to like starting things with the right. Okay? Whether that was in his combing of his hair, or in putting on his shoes, his sandals, or in his purification, and all of the rest of his affairs. So the Prophet would love to start with the right. So based upon that, we can say that you start with the right when it comes to doing the siwa. Which hand should you use? Both hands, right? Can you imagine?
No.
Which hand should you use when making the siwa, the salam?
Left.
Left. Anybody disagree with the shaykh? Any other fatwa? Okay, left, sah. It's left if it's izalat al-adha. Izalat al-adha mean if it's removing some type of harm. Like we said, it's opening your mouth, there's something, it's cleaning your mouth, right? Then it should be the left. But if it's not due to that, then it can be the right. Are you? The left, like we said before, is for that which is for what you generally use for cleaning adha, right? When you come from the bathroom, etc. So also here, when you're cleaning your mouth, then you use the left. If you're not doing it for cleaning, rather you're doing it for Allah's reward, then you do it with the right, and Allah knows best. What did the Imam say next? He says, وَيَدَّهِنُ غِبًا. Okay, in Abu Dawud and Ahmad, the hadith of Abdullah ibn Mu'affan, رضي الله عنه, the Prophet he said, نهى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن الترجل إلا غبا. The Prophet forbade that one make tarajjul except the ghibban. Ghibban is one day on and one day off. And tarajjul is tasrih al-sha'ar wa duhni. Tarajjul, this word in the hadith, which the Prophet forbade, is to comb your hair and to put some type of, not wax, because I didn't have wax, any type of grease on your hair, right? To keep your hair in place or to make it healthy, etc. So the Prophet forbade this, unless it be one day on and one day off. Okay? The Prophet forbade you to comb your hair every single day and to beautify your hair every single day. Because this is from overdoing the luxury of this dunya. And it makes the people weak. You see brothers today, you can't distinguish who spends more time in front of the mirror, him or his wife. One hair is out, I'm not going to the party. You know? It's a problem, overdoing it. Some people are like this now, they have issues with men. A man is supposed to have a rajula. But also the ulama, they say if your hair is in a state that it gets messy, if you don't comb it, then for sure you can comb it every single day. But it shouldn't be because you want to compete with those people who are put on the cosmetic magazines or all unnatural anyway. But yeah, the Imam he says, وَيَفْتَهِنُ وِتْرًا وَيَفْتَهِنُ وِتْرًا. Go ahead. Ijtihad is to like you do in your eyes. Mascara, right? Mascara. You know what we mean, right? Use the mascara on your eyes, okay? So the Imam says you do this 3 times in the hadith of Ahmad and Abu Dawud and Ibn Majah. We have the hadith of Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. He says, كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يجتحد بالإثم كل ليلة قبل المنام. That the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to use this mascara on his eyes, okay? Made from ithmid. Before he would sleep. وَكَانَ يَكْتَحِدُ فِي كُلِّ أَيْنِ ثَلَاثَةَ أَمْيَانِ. And the Prophet ﷺ would do in each one 3 strokes. So in each eye, 3 strokes. So 6 strokes altogether. Again. But some of the ulama, like Shaykh Hassan al-Dalila, he said that you shouldn't do this if you find that you become a fitna for the women. That if you're so gorgeous and good looking, you shouldn't do this. Because at the time of Umar radiallahu anhu, there was a tabi by the name of Nasr ibn al-Hajjaj, and he was known to have really beautiful hair. His hair was amazing, so much so that the women, they would be tempted by him. So Umar radiallahu anhu forced him to shave his hair like this. But But when he shaved his hair, he became even more beautiful, even more handsome. So Umar had to send it to Iraq. Right? So anyway, the quote from the hadith, as mentioned by Shaykh Hassan Da'ila, in his explanation, is that you should be careful of how you beautify yourself. If you're somebody that's too good looking, hold it back a bit for me then. So the Imam says, وَتَجِبُوا أَتَسْمِيَةُ فِي الْوُضُوِي مَعَ الذِّكْرِ. And to make the tasmiyah, the basmalah, bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, in the wudu, whilst being able to remember, is wajib, is obligatory. You could say dhikr or you could say dhukr, as mentioned by Shaykh Mutlaq al-Jasr. You could say dhikr or dhukr, right? So the Imam here, he said that it's obligatory for you to do what? To say the basmalah in the wudu. Why is he mentioning it here? I thought we were talking about sunnah actions. Isn't that the case? We're talking about sunnah actions of wudu, and now he's mentioning wajib. What's going on? What do you think? Sheikh Ahmed Khalil, in his explanation, he said he's doing this to show that he differs with those who say that it's sunnah. Okay, so he's mentioning here to show that he differs with those, which is the majority, that say that the basmalah in the wudu is sunnah. That's the reason he mentioned it here. In the hadith collected by Imam Ahmed Abu Dawood and others, Prophet said, لا صلاة لمن لا وضوء له ولا وضوء لمن لم يذكر اسم الله تعالى عليه. There is no prayer for the one that doesn't have wudu. And there is no wudu for the one that doesn't mention the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the proof from among the many proofs of the Imam that it's wajib. طيب. The author said, he put a condition. He said that he's saying the basmalah is wajib, but he said with remembering. Right, so if you forget it, yasqut ma'a al-nisyan. It's one of those things which is foregone if you forgot it. What does this mean if you forgot it? If you forgot it at the beginning, the middle, the end, what?
No punishment for
it. Now I'm talking about the ruling itself. How do you apply the ruling? So that Imam is telling us that it's foregone for you if you forget it. What's the tasweel of the mas'ala? Is it at the beginning of the wudu, it's okay if you forgot it? The middle of the wudu, it's okay if you forgot it? Or at the end of the wudu, it's okay if you forgot it? Yes, after wudu has been completed and you moved away, then it's okay. But if you forgot it in the middle, then it's ahwat. It's better for you and safer for you to repeat your wudu, right, from the beginning. If you remember in the middle, start your wudu again. But if you did it afterwards, if you remember after the wudu, then it's okay for you. Yasqut ma'a al-nisyan. Imams of the Madhab al-Khiraqi and Ibn Qudama, they hold that it's mustahab to say the wudu is something which is sunnah and recommended, it's not wajib. Okay? This is the second opinion in the Madhab. And Imam Ahmad went as far as saying that nothing is really authentically reported in this matter, and no one was best. The Imam, he says, وَيَجْبُ الْخِتَانُ مَا لَمْ يَخَفْ عَلَى نَفْسِهِ. It's imperative, it's obligatory that the person makes the khitam, circumcision, as long as he does the faith for himself. In Bukhari Muslim, the hadith of Abu Huraira, radiallahu anhu, he said the Prophet said, خَمْسُ مِنَ الْفِطْرَ, that there are five things from the fitra. Fitra is the state that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased and wants you to be in. خَمْسُ مِنَ الْفِطْرَ, al-khitam. The first of them he mentioned al-khitam. The first of these things is that you should be in a state of circumcision. طيب. The opinion of the madhab that it's obligatory for both men and for women. It's obligatory for both men and for women. Okay? Ibn Qudama and Imam Ahmad himself, they said it's obligatory for the men but recommended for the women. So it's not obligatory for the women according to Imam Ahmad and Ibn Qudama. But the other scholars of the madhab, they say no, it's obligatory on both. Is there a logical proof that this khitan, the circumcision, is wajib for the men and not sunnah? It's obligatory for the men and not sunnah for the men. What's the logical proof that it's obligatory for a man and not sunnah for a man? Because somebody may say it's only sunnah. Tayyib, I'm asking for logical proof, not proof from the nas. What happens when somebody's going to do khitan to you? What happens to you? What happens to your clothing? Clothing gets removed, right? So your aura becomes exposed. And your aura cannot be exposed. This is something which is prohibited. So the prohibition cannot happen for a sunnah. Therefore, logically, it can only happen for that which is obligatory, for that which is wajib. طيب. When should the ikhtiyar take place? The ulama, they say it should take place before puberty, and it becomes obligatory at the time of puberty. Okay? But for you to do beforehand is better for you. It's obligatory at the time of puberty, but for you to do before that is better for you. Okay? And this is one of those instances where they said that a mustahab or a sunnah is better than a wajib. Because I'm saying to you, it's wajib when you become, reach the age of puberty, but better for you to do beforehand. So this is one of those situations that there are not many, with the mustahab is better than the wajib. Okay? Understanding what I'm saying? And there's another one of them, for example, when you give the salam. What's the ruling of the one who gives salam? Sunnah, recommended, right? Mustahab. What's the ruling of the reply? And who is better according to the hadith? The one who starts. Okay? The one who's better, the one who starts. This is another example of where mustahab can be better than the wajib. We said, or the Imam said, that you should do the circumcision as long as what? Huh? As long as you don't favor yourself. Now this fear, how do I know this fear? Is it something in my mind? No, it's something which a trustworthy doctor must have told me. A trustworthy doctor that, look, for you, your age, or whatever other reason, you shouldn't do circumcision, okay? And it's a trustworthy doctor, it's going to harm you. And the ulama, they have a ruling fiqh, where they say, la wajib ma la ajz. There's no wajib in the state of inability. Wa la muharram ma la ittirar. And there's nothing haram in the state of being compelled. La wajib ma la ajz. There's no obligation in the state of inability. Wa la muharram ma la ittirar. And there's no haram in the state of being compelled. The Imam says, wa yukrahu al-qaza'. And it's disliked to do al-qaza'. In the hadith of Bukhari Muslim, narrated by Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, he said, Naha Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam an al-qaza'. That the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam forbade you to do qaza'. Nobody here has qaza'. So it's not become. Qaza' is that when you shave a part of your hair and you leave that part of your hair. How can that take place? From here? From the sides of you. Yeah, you can remove the sides. What else can you do for qaza'? You can remove the middle. You can remove the front, leaving the back. You can remove the back, leaving the front. So all of these strange and weird things, right? Falls under this, that's makruh. And the reason that it's taken to the level of the sarif, the thing which takes it to the level of makruh, is ijma. Imam Nawawi, rahimahullah ta'ala, said there's ijma on this issue, that the qaza' is makruh. Okay? So that's what takes the prohibition from being prohibited to the level of what? To the level of being makruh. When can it be haram? Qaza'. We said the ruling of qaza' that is makruh, dislike. When can it be haram? Is there a situation when you have that haircut and it can actually be haram? Rather than just being makruh? Imitating who? Imitating the kuffar, okay, you want to be like them, copying that, or you're imitating evil people. Because the Prophet said, "Man tashabbaha biqaumin fahuwa minhum." Whoever imitates the people, then he's of them, right? So it's something prohibited to imitate that which is specific to a people. The Prophet said, "Wamin sunnah al-wudu al-siwak wa ghusl al-kaffayn thalath." And from the sunnah of wudu is to use the siwak and to wash your hands three times. What is sunnah? What do you understand by sunnah in fiqh?
Something that's recommended, but if you don't do it, you don't get it.
Good, good. مَنْ ثَابُ فَاعِلِهِ امْتِثَالًا وَلَا يُعَاقِبُهُ وَلَا يُعَاقِبُ تَارِكِهِ. Okay? مَنْ ثَابُ فَاعِلِهِ امْتِثَالًا. The one who does it is rewarded if he did it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? And the one who leaves it is not punished. This is the definition of sunnah in fiqh. And with this verb in particular, the verb of wudu, it means everything which is not a condition and everything which is not a wajib. Okay? Then it will be sunnah. So the Imam says that you wash your hands, what? Three times. And this is the hadith of Umran, Mawla Uthman Ibn Affan radiallahu anhu, Bukhari Muslim, where he said, ضعف من بوضوء فغسل يديه ثلاث فغسل كفيه ثلاث ثم تمدمد واستنشق ثم غسل وجهه ثلاث ثم غسل يديه الى مرفقه ثلاث ثم غسل رجليه ثلاث. Okay, to the end of the hadith. And in case the hadith is Bukhari Muslim, the hadith of Mawla Uthman ibn Affan, the servant of Uthman radiallahu anhu, who said that I saw Uthman brings up calling for some water, and then he washed his kafain three times. The kaf is from your fingertips until your wrist. Okay? From your fingertips until your wrist. This is what's recommended for you to wash at the beginning of the wudu. What can be from the wisdoms of you doing that? Why would the Prophet, why would the Sharia encourage us as a sunnah, as a mustahab, to wash your hands three times? Because your hands are the vessel that is carrying the water. So for your hands to be clean is better for you when you're making the wudu rain. So your hands is the vessel that is carrying the water. So this is from one of the wisdoms. Then the Imam says, and it's obligatory for you to wash your hands before the wudu. So we're saying it's sunnah for you to wash your hands three times before wudu. Now we're saying to you, it's obligatory for you to wash your hands before wudu. If you are somebody who's got up from a sleep at night, which was deep enough to break your wudu. Remember the hadith we took a few weeks ago? The hadith of Abu Hurairah, where the Prophet said, إِذَا سَلَيْقَ لَأَحْدَكُمْ مِنْ نَوْمِهِ فَلَا يَقْمِ زَيْدَهُ فِي الْإِنَا حَتَّى يَقْسِلَهَا ثَلَاثَ فَإِنَّهُ لَا يَدْرِي أَيْنَ بَاتَ لِلَّهِ. If one of you gets up from the night's sleep, then he shouldn't put his hand into the vessel until he washes it three times. Or verily, he doesn't know where his hands have been. So if that's the situation, then it's obligatory to wash your hands before the wudu. Sheikh Hamad al-Hamad, in his explanation of that al-Mustaqnia, he says, this washing is separate to the wudu, therefore it doesn't have to be in close proximity of time to the wudu. It can be done, you know, some time before the wudu itself, right? And again, if you forget to do this, then it's like the basmala, yasqut bin nisyan. It's overlooked due to forgetting, right? It's overlooked due to forgetting. The Imam says, وَالْقُدَاءَةُ بِمَغْبَضَةٍ ثُمَّ اسْتِنْشَاقٍ. Also sunnah is for you to start with the maghbada and the istinshaq. Maghbada is idaatul ma'i fi fam adna idaar. Idaatul ma'i fi fam adna idaar. For you to move water around in your mouth in the least of ways, okay? For you to just swish the water around in your mouth in the least of ways. This is the maghbada. Istinshaq is that you sniff water into your nose. Okay? So maghbada is to move it around in your mouth. Istinshaq is that you sniff the water into your nose. And istinthar is that you remove the water from your nose. So you have maghbada, you have istinshaq, you have istinthar. So the Imam is saying that it's sunnah for you to what? To start your wudu after washing your hands with the maghbada and the istinshaq. Imam Ibn Qayyim, he said, لَمْ يَجِئَ الْفَصَلْ بَيْنَ الْمَضْمَضَى وَالْإِسْتِنْشَاقِ فِي حَدِيثِ صَحِيحَ الْبَتَّ. He said, it never came in any authentic hadith whatsoever that there was a separation between the madmada and the istinshaq. It should be done in one go. Okay? According to this Imam of Hadith and Fiqh and many other sciences. Right? The istinthar, which is removing the water once you've blown it first, sniffed it into your nose, the istinthar, which hand should be done with, the right or the left?
Left. Left.
Left, because it's as a hand to hand, because it's the removing of that which is harmful, right? And also this is based upon a hadith in the Sunnah of Imam al-Nisa'i, and Sheikh Hamad said the chain in that hadith is authentic. Madhmada and istinshaq, right? Later on, in the chapter of wudu, we will come to know that they are obligatory actions. They're not sunnah actions. So why is the Imam trying to make your head spin when he's mentioned it here in the portion pertaining to that which is sunnah? Madhmada and istinshaq is obligatory. Why is the Imam mentioning it here with the portion of things which are sunnah? No.
Is it part of your face?
Good, you're close. He's talking about it's sunnah for you to start with it. Okay? It's sunnah for you to start with the madmada and the istinshaq before you wash your face. Okay? But to do it is obligatory. To do both of those limbs are obligatory. But to start with that is something which is sunnah, as mentioned by Shaykh Abdullah Jaz. Pertaining to washing in the wudu, those limbs which are one, right, like your head, then it doesn't matter how you wash that limb, whether you wash it from the left or you wash it from the right, okay? But if it's two, like your arms and your hands and your feet, then you should start with the right instead of the left, right? So the limb which is one, your face, it doesn't matter how you wash it. Whether you start with the face first, if you start with the nose first, the mouth first, okay? But what's important is that you try to follow the sunnah to the best of your ability. The Imam says, وَالْمُبَالَغَةُ فِيهِمَا لِغَيْرِ صَعِبٍ. And that you make mubalagha when you do the madmada is the shah. Mubalagha is that you exaggerate a little bit. Exaggerate in the amount of water that you put in your mouth and your nose. Exaggerate in the amount that you sniff and the amount that you swish around your mouth. Okay? This is taken from the hadith of Abu Dawud and Tirmidhi, the hadith of Laqid ibn Sabara, radiallahu anhu, where the Prophet said, Asbil al-wudu, complete your wudu to the best of your ability. Isbaq al-wudu, this word Asbil al-wudu is literally that you ensure that your limbs of the wudu are fully covered with the water that should be covering them. Okay, this is Isbaq al-wudu. So he said, Asbil al-wudu, wa khalil bayn al-asabi', and do this between your toes and your fingers. وَبَالَغْ فِي الْإِسْتِنْشَاقِ, and don't exaggerate in the istinshaq, taking water into your mouth. إِلَّا أَنْ تَكُونَ صَائِمًا. Okay, unless you are fasting. Unless you are fasting. Why shouldn't you do it if you are fasting? Because it could break your fast, right? It could go down your throat. In the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ mentioned the istinshaq, but he didn't mention the madmada. Why do you think that is? Though the ruling is for both, that you shouldn't make exaggeration in the madmada or the istinshaq if you are fasting. But he only mentioned istinshaq and not madmada. Because the madmada, it's easier for you to control the water. Whereas the istinshaq, when you make mubalagha, it's more difficult for you. So it's more likely that you're going to break your fast with the istinshaq than it is the madmada. Okay? طيب. Also from this hadith that we on, the hadith Laqid ibn Sabra, where he said, do the exaggeration in the istinshaq unless you are fasting, right? Unless you are fasting. The ulama, they said, at times you can leave a sunnah in order to avoid a prohibition or to achieve an obligation. At times you can leave off a sunnah in order to avoid a prohibition or achieve an obligation. Imam Taymiyyah, in his fatawa, he mentioned, for example, that ta'lif al-qulub bayn al-mu'mineen, that to join the hearts of the Muslims is something which is wajib. So if you were to, in some situations, leave off the sunnah in order to achieve that objective, then this is something which is highly recommended. Okay? And Sheikh Hassan al-Da'ila, in his explanation, he said, for example, if you are praying with those who are shafi'i, and in Fajr, in their qunut, they make qunut in the Fajr, but you don't see it as being sunnah. He said, if you're praying with them, you should still do it, and you should say ameen. Why? Because in order to join the heart, and so that there's no difference of the heart. And even if you are the imam for them, and you don't hold it to be sunnah, then you should still do it for that sake. But of course, all of this requires fiqh. It's not just something I decide that here I should use the sunnah, and here I should use the sunnah. No, you need some fiqh, and you need to speak to people of knowledge. But the point being is that at times the sunnah can be left off to avoid a prohibition or to achieve an obligation. And the most important of obligations is that of joining the hearts of the believers. طيب. The Imam says also from the sunnah is what تَخْلِيلُ اللَّحْيَا الْخَدِيفَ, is to make takhleel, rubbing of the beard if it is thick. So in the hadith of Abu Dawud, at-Tirmidhi, Uthman radiallahu anhu said, كَانَ النَّبِي صلى الله عليه وسلم يُخَلِّلُ لَحْيَتَهُ فِي الْوُضُوء, that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to make takhleel of his lahya in wudu. So the Imam, he said, if your lahya is khatif, if it's thick, then you have to do it, right? What do you do if you don't have the fiqh left here? If your bed is not thick, you cannot pick it up in the head, don't worry. If your bed is not thick, you should make it thick, grow it. It's something which is sunnah, something which is beloved to the believers. In fact, Aisha radiallahu anha, she used to say, glory be to Allah, the beautified man with his bed. Right? And many times the Prophet turned away from people that didn't have their bed grown. Okay? Something which is imperative to take care of. Grow your bed. So here, the khlil is that you take a bit of water and you rub it under the under your chin. Or you wet your hands and you use your hands like a comb. Okay? To rub the hair. This is sunnah. Okay? It's not a must. It's a must for you to do if you have a short bed. If your bed is short and from your bed you can see your skin. If the skin can be seen, then it's wajib. It's obligatory for you to rub your skin. Okay? Sunnah if you have a thick bed. Okay? Obligatory for you to rub your skin if you don't have enough hair. Well, asabi', and to make the khlil of the asabi', to make the khlil of the fingers or the toes, right? Some say fingers are included, but in any case, to make the khlil of the toes, going back to the hadith and the hadith ibn Surah that we just mentioned, right? Before the hadith we just mentioned now. So how do you make this takhlil of your toes? The ulama they say, bil khinsa, min al-khinsa ila al-khinsa. From your little finger, with your little finger, from your little toe to your little toe. So your left little finger, from your right toe all the way till you reach your left foot toe. With the little finger, the left, on your right foot starting, your little toe, all the way to the little toe of your left foot. And at-tayamum. At-tayamum is to do the right hand side of your washing first. To do the right hand side of your washing first, yeah? Where do we take this from? Sunnah to do that. The hadith we mentioned before by Aisha radiallahu anha, which said the Prophet used to love to start with his right. Okay, and also we have this hadith in Tirmidhi and Abu Dawood, and Shaykh Hamad al-Hamad said that the Islam, the chain of creation, is hasan, is good in this hadith. But the Prophet said, إِذَا لَمِسْتُمْ وَإِذَا تَوَضَّأْتُمْ فَابْدَأُوا بِمَا يَأْمِنِكُمْ. That if you put on your clothes and you make wudu, then start with the right. Start with the right hand side of this. And this is the sunnah that is ijma. There is ijma that this is sunnah. What about on your face, washing the right hand side of your face before the left hand side of your face? What about wiping the left hand side of your head? Sorry, the right hand side of your head before the left hand side of your head. Is this something you think is recommended? Exactly. Otherwise, the ulama said this is taqalluf. This is gaining. This is making things difficult for yourself. There's no need to do that. Doing your right hand side before your left hand, okay, on the right hand side of your head, to the before the left hand side of your head. They said it's only in those limbs which are jewels. Wa akhu man jadid li udhanayn. And also from the sunnah of wudu is to take new water, okay, for the ears, to ensure that you have your fingers wet before you wipe the ears by dipping them into the water, okay? Another riwayah from Imam Ahmad, another narration from Imam Ahmad is that this is only something which is not mustahab. But rather, you should use the wetness which you have in your hands from after wiping your hair. Okay? This is another narration from Imam Ahmad. وَالْغَسْلَةُ الثَّانِيَةُ وَالثَّالِثَةُ. And the second and the third washing is also something which is sunnah. The first washing in the wudu is wajib, obligatory. The second and third washing is sunnah. Sheikh Mansour, in his explanation, which he entitled Ta'liq al-Mughni ala Zad al-Mustaqnia, Sheikh Mansour, in his explanation, he said this comes in four different ways. The sunnah washing comes in four different ways. The first is to do everything three times, right? The second is to do everything two times. The third is to do everything one time. The fourth is to do everything three times, except for the hands you do it two times. Right? So the sunnah washing in the wudu is either you do everything three times, either you do everything two times, either you do everything one time, either you do everything three times, except the hands you just do it two times. What if you forget and you washed the right hand 3 times and you do the left hand 2 times. Would that affect your wudu? No, it won't affect your wudu, okay? But of course you should try to concentrate to the best of your ability not to fall into that situation. We have in the hadith of Ahmad and Abi Dawood and Nisa'i where the Prophet ﷺ is narrated by Amr ibn Shu'ayb, who said, Amr ibn Shu'ayb, he said, جَاءَ رَجُلٌ جَاءَ عَرَبِيٌ إِلَى رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَسْأَلُهُ عَنِ الْوُضُوءِ. A Bedouin Arab came to the Prophet ﷺ asking him about wudu, how to make wudu. فَأَرَاهُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ الْوُضُوءُ ثَلَاثَ. So the Prophet ﷺ showed him wudu 3 times, washing it 3 times each body part. And then the Prophet ﷺ said, هَكَذَا الْوُضُوءُ. This is how you make wudu. فَمَنْ زَادَ عَلَى هَذَا. And whoever goes beyond this, meaning the 3 times, فَقَدْ أَسَاءَ وَتَعَدَّى وَظَلَمَ. That he has done evil, he has done wrong, and he has gone beyond the bounds, and he has done oppression. He shouldn't do that. It's something which is not allowed to do. To wash more than 3 times. طيب. We'll stop here inshallah before we move on to the chapter of that which is obligatory in the wudu and that which is from the description of the wudu, because I'm super tired after driving for 15 minutes in the traffic, and I'm sure you guys are also. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward everyone for the immense effort for trying to attend, even though all these football fans are trying to prevent us from doing so. But I make it every now and then scared of Qudus Ameen, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and said anything which was correct. From Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, mistakes and shortcomings from myself, which we find. And if you have any questions.